Thank you. Dai Ki
Jai.
Shri Prabhupada Ki
Jai.
The lotus feet of our spiritual master are the holy evangelist in the place of your devotional service. I bow down at his lotus feet with great honor and reverence. By his grace, I have crossed the ocean of philosophy and obtained the mercy of Krishna. My only wish is to have my consciousness purified by the words emanating from his lotus heart. Attachment to his lotus feet is the protection that fulfills all desires. He opens my darkened eyes and fills my heart with transcendental knowledge. He is my deliverer of the world. From him ecstatic remnants, my ignorance is discovered. The Vedic scriptures seem his character. Our spiritual master is the ocean of mercy, the friend of the poor and the ones of the devotees. All master, be merciful to us, and give us the shade of your lotus feet. Your face spreads all over the universe.
Shri Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jaya Prabhupada.
Bye. This is the last morning of your main retreat. I know some of our minds are already reaching out to the other destinations, the places where we return. I still request you to pay attention because this morning and in the workshop, we are trying to round everything up and make it complete so that you will actually be able to take your experience home and then practice chanting with much more focus and absorption and make it more of a priority in your life than until now, hopefully. So, yes, let us start.
Nde ra ka Thank you. died in the battlefield, and
bodies were collected and then burned, and then, yes, the ceremony of going into a sacred body of water and offering something on behalf. Now, when her sons were just ready, her mother, Kunti, was bursting in tears and more than before, it was just besides herself with grief. And Pandava asked her, "Mother, what is troubling your mind?" And she was saying, "There's one last tapana, one last offering to the dead, which needs to be done. It's an offering for your brother." Brother? We are five brothers. We are complete. We have survived. No, your eldest brother has been killed by the third eldest. No, is it fourth eldest brother? Fool! Karna. And then she revealed that the one who was acting as one of the arch enemies of the Pandavas was the eldest brother, born from her, fed by her own breast, a child which she loved like any mother loves her child. That child, Karna, was killed by Arjuna, Yudhishthira, Bhima, and then Arjuna, and this was a shocking news for the five Pandavas. So she had gone through a lot of trials and a lot of turmoils. This perhaps the strongest. So let us read her words now. She addresses Krishna. "I wish that all those calamities would happen again and again." What? "So that we could see you again and again. For seeing you means that we will no longer see repeated births and deaths." We need to really understand what is going on. She apparently asks for more trouble again and again. Why so? Is there some default function now in her? Was the trouble too much and she has gone a little bit, there's a little challenge in her life? Or what is going on in her thinking? She reasons, she says, "You were with us all this when we were in trouble. You were saving us. Seeing you, having your darshan, my Lord, that is the best thing which can happen to all of us. Then we will no longer see repeated birth and death. That's the perfection of human existence. You came at that time. Now we are situated, the battle is over, Yudhishthira is the emperor of the world, everyone has their palaces, no longer living in exile, but you are now going to Dwaraka and living somewhere else. But when we were in trouble, you were right by our side. So therefore, may the trouble return. Because more important than a happy life is to be with you, Krishna." Purport. "Generally, the distressed, the needy, the intelligent, and the inquisitive who have performed some pious activities worship or begin to worship the Lord." Four motivations: distress, neediness, the try to become more wise and some curiosity. These people begin to worship you. Others who are thriving on misdeeds only, regardless of status, cannot approach the Supreme Lord due to being misled by the illusory energy. Therefore, for a pious person, if there is some calamity, there is no other alternative than to take shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord. Constantly remembering the lotus feet of the Lord means preparing for liberation from birth and death. Therefore, even though there are so-called calamities, they are welcome because they give us an opportunity to remember the Lord, which means liberation. One who has taken shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord, which are accepted as the most suitable boat for crossing the ocean of nations, can achieve liberation as easily as one leaps over the holes made by the calf, not made by the hooves, sorry, of a calf. So the one who has taken shelter of the lotus feet can cross the ocean of misery as easy as you can jump over the footprint of the calf. Such persons are meant to reside in the abode of the Lord. They have nothing to do with a place where there is danger in every step. This material world is certified by the Lord in the Bhagavad Gita as a dangerous place full of calamities. Less intelligent persons prepare plans to adjust to those calamities without knowing that the nature of this place is itself full of calamities. They have no information of the abode of the Lord, which is full of bliss and without trace of calamity. The duty of the sane person, therefore, is to be undisturbed by worldly calamities, which are sure to happen in all circumstances. Suffering all sorts of unavoidable misfortunes, one should make progress in spiritual realization, because that is the mission of human life. The spirit soul is transcendental to all material calamities. Therefore, the so-called calamities are called false. Not real. Prabhupada now supplies an example of this, or an analogy. A man may see a tiger swallowing him up in a dream, and he may cry for this calamity, help! But actually there is no tiger, and there is no suffering. It is simply a case of dreams. In the same way, all calamities of life are said to be dreams. If someone is lucky enough to get in contact with the Lord by devotional service, it's all gain. Contact with the Lord by any one of the 9 devotional services is always a forward step on the path going back to Godhead. I think all of us have made many forward steps because we have tried to focus more on the chanting. Right, let me read this again. Contact with the Lord by any one of the 9 devotional services, chanting is one of them, is always a forward step on the path going back to Godhead. Namo Vishnu Padaya.
Krishna Prasaya Bhuvane Shriyate Bhakti Vedanta Swami spiritual world.
Here you will be like a fish out of the ocean, but who has a small little aquarium, you know, with nice fish food, and so on. No? Yeah. This is a question which everyone has to raise, and I know the young people will all say, I'm going back to Godhead, I'm detaching myself from material illusion. And the holy bodies will think, that's a good question. There's a very nice song, and I want to, sorry, I respect. So Queen Kunti, in this amazing prayer, is saying, I really want something else. I want to be in your presence. Today I asked one devotee to write down the verse, and he knew this verse and said, aha, Maharaj, you want to talk about the misery verse. What? No, she says in this verse, she wants calamities again and again. It's a misery. She wants misery. I said, have you read the second part of the verse? That is the part where it's all about. She wants to be with Krishna. That's the idea of this verse. And she's ready to make a trade-off. She said, I don't go for material development. This can let it go its way, and if there's misery, no problem. I want to be with Krishna. This is the response of young spiritualists. They think not having a comfortable material life, that is misery. And it's not wrong. This is not the idea. You want to be with Krishna. And in her case, it was that when she had when they were banished in the forest, Krishna visited the Pandavas regularly and guided them through life. And now she appeared. Now where everything is all right, maybe you won't come so often to us. Krishna continued to come often. But this is a fear feeling. My dear devotees, this verse and the unenlightened question of the young devotee points us into a very important direction. That is Krishna Sharana. The shelter at Krishna's lotus feet. Only when you go for the shelter of Krishna does Krishna become of prime importance for you, and only then will your perspective change. At that time, when you are either approaching Krishna for shelter or you feel already Krishna's shelter, at that time, even a visit to the dentist, that is for me the absolute misery. I cannot think of more misery than a dental visit. Even that becomes, this is all right, it's not so important, it's not overwhelming. Because you have something higher. A higher taste helps you to overcome the problems which happen when you have a lower taste. There are 24 qualities of a devotee, and of all these 24, one is the most important, and in the way we express it, it's the angi. It means it's the body of devotion in the life. And all the other 23 are the limbs. They are extending from this principle. And this first and foremost principle of a Vaishnava is Krishnaika Sharana, shelter at Krishna's lotus feet.
Now, the question obviously is, how can I find this shelter? How can I find this admirable position which will give me such a taste that I will no longer be dependent on the flimsy up and down of happiness and distress? Means, what I want to express, the coming and going of happiness and distress, which is coming like day and night, or like the seasons, it's unavoidable. Now, how can I obtain the shelter in the most practical way? And in order to answer this question, I would very much like to sing a song, but because I'm not so talented, I will better speak it, to not scare you. It's from Gitavali, a song collection of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who sings, "You should understand this essential fact. Life is temporary and filled with various kinds of misery. Therefore, take shelter carefully of the Holy Name and remain always engaged in the service as your eternal occupation." Take shelter in the Holy Name. Nama Shraya, the word Kori Jatamatuni. Desiring to shower blessings upon all living entities, this sweet name of Krishna has come to this material universe and shines like the sun in the sky of the heart, destroying the darkness of ignorance. Beautiful poetry, isn't it? There is a motivation. The Lord wants to give blessings and therefore has come as his holy names to the material universe. And when you take shelter in that name, then it will shine like the sun in the sky of your heart. Dahara Akash in Sanskrit. Akash means the sky. And Dahara Akash. The name will rise in the sky of the heart and will destroy the darkness of ignorance. Christian, you are in great discomfort because of the sun, isn't it?
It's fine.
It's all fine, yeah. Oh, sympathetic. Our Christian is not interested in comfort. He is interested in Krishna. I remember a poem of Rumi, and we had a humorous encounter yesterday. I said to a devotee, "I want to recite a poem to you." So I started. Undiscovered beauty, that is what you are for me. And the devotee goes, "What? Listen, it's not about you, it's about God." Undiscovered beauty, that is what you are for me at the moment. But one day, like the rising sun, you will rise in my heart. Beautiful, no? I think Rumi would be an enthusiastic member of the Hare Krishna movement, because here the whole idea, the same idea is given. The name of Krishna, Krishna in the form of the name, has descended to this material universe and shines like the sun in the sky of the heart, destroying the darkness of ignorance. Without the holy name, there's nothing within the 14th verse. Therefore, drink the pure nectar of the holy name of Krishna and thus satisfy the soul of Bhaktivinoda. My dear devotees, Krishna consciousness is a wonderful opportunity to actually do something practical in terms of Krishnaika Shavaram, coming into the shelter of Krishna. It is so practical, because you can do this by taking full shelter of the holy name. I would like to, if it's not boring for you, say something, an illustration of my own life, of my child. I don't know, I was a child. I was a very, very energetic child, really energetic. I saw pictures and so on. And my parents lived in constant anxiety that one day this child will run away and not return. When I became younger, I did this. So anyways, I was my grandfather, who was the main educational influence in my life, because I would not I would be too bored in school. Now, he would go with me on walks, and the moment we were out of the house, my grandfather has informed. I don't remember so clearly, but he had informed me. That moment, I was ripping my hand out of his hand. I was small, ripping my hand out of his hand, and I would say, I cannot go alone. And I would run here and there, climb trees and hide behind bushes and frighten passengers. Ooh! And do all the things little boys do in Germany, at least. But the moment there was just a dog was coming, I would run to my grandfather. I would push my hand into his hand. And I would go next to him, because I had made a very bad experience when I was still smaller. I had been attacked by a dog really badly. He had ripped my pants. He didn't hurt me. I think he did a joke. But even to this day, when there are dogs, I behave properly. So I remember it was a traumatic childhood experience. But the moment I was with my grandfather, I felt sheltered, even from the dogs, which for my child, like mine, was the greatest danger in existence. So from that, I remember, when one feels sheltered, and one walks in the shelter, then one is not afraid any longer. One is at peace. Everything is taken care of for a person who is sheltered. So, this form of shelter is experienced, the divine shelter, for someone who has taken shelter in the holy name. And the good thing, my dear devotees, is you have always the holy name. You can always, under all circumstances, chant. Yes, even when you are in the office and you cannot chant out loud, but there is a boring board meeting and you have to attend. Chant in the mind. No? You can always take shelter at Krishna's lotus feet by chanting. And in this way, lose the fear of material existence, or the discomfort which we all feel as fishes who are outside our real water. No? The discomfort which is either inner discomfort, you don't feel just right. Oh, this conversation doesn't go well. Oh, no, some discomfort may be there. We can, if we are sheltered, that this rain of misery will not strike us. So, therefore, Namashraya, shelter at the lotus feet of the holy name, is the greatest goal for us to attain in this world. Because of all of Krishna's forms, you know, his different avatars, his eternal form in the spiritual world, his deity form, which is in this world, the holy name is most accessible. You can chant him day and night and in various circumstances, including when you shower. He can always be with you, just like your breath. This is so close to you, like your breath. It never leaves you. However, and let me use this word now three times. However, not a spiritual word. But, this means now a limiting phrase will come up. What I've said now, I will look at it now very closely. Is this really working for you? Is this really an experienced fact for you? Have you found shelter? Have you lost your anxieties as a result of that? Are you Krishnaika or Namaika Sharana? Or do you have Namashraya? We know that this is not so easy, because our mind, which is often under the control of Rajagun, convinces us that we are the doers, that we should rule our life. Only someone who does not think he can do it, he will take shelter. It's not something, you know, we hear the philosophy, but ask yourself, have I realized this? Is this a fact in my life? Our false ego has created what Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, the mana manush. Mana manush, what is this? The mentally imagined man. In philosophy, all of us, even in the ladies or female gender, we have created a Purusha mentality, an enjoyer and controller mentality. And we are convinced that at the time that there's something pricking us, that we should now get serious and do something about it. Yes, we must of course do, you know, I'm not speaking of absolutely non-doership, but I'm trying to hint out, my dear devotees, we are not the only creator. There is a much more powerful creator. We are maybe co-creators of our life, in the sense that we can desire to go a certain path. And this co-creatorship should be done. But nothing will ever work without the consent of the Lord. The Lord has another plan. Your plan will not work out. He is the real Purusha, and you are the mentally imagined Purusha of your life. Who of you has read the book Siddhartha? I don't know how many of you have read. Herman has or secretly read him. Siddhartha, which has moved a whole generation, my young generation, to look into spiritual things, was written by Hermann Hesse, an author. He used a certain pen. I think I once saw in a museum the pen, but I might be mistaken, maybe another pen. I don't remember very clearly. It was long, long back when I was not yet practicing Krishna consciousness. My mother took me to all possible museums in the world. So there, imagine the pen of this book, Siddhartha would say, I wrote Siddhartha. I should get the literature prize, not because it was me who wrote it. It's my ink here. I can prove it. What would we say to such a speaking pen? Our first question would be, are you speaking? But if he would speak, we would say, you are ill, you are dull-witted, you are not understanding. It was a human being who had all the ideas, who made you do this. So in the same way, the Lord is behind everyone's destiny. He has written the book of destiny for everyone. He's the author. But you are also someone. You can approach the Lord. I wish to do this. I wish to do that. And the Lord will, many times when it's in his plan and it's good for you, then you will go ahead. Yes. He's very kind to us. But it's important for a spiritualist to know that I am the pen and the Lord is the author, not vice versa. I am not using the Lord for my life. The Lord is the Lord is working through me. This waking up from this ego means waking up from the dream world. Only someone who is intelligent enough to understand the Lord is the mover and I'm the moved. Will be able to take serious shelter. As long as we are convinced by Rajagun, which infuses our mind that we are the only doers of our life, we will not be able so much to take shelter at Krishna's lotus feet. So I'm almost come to the end. There is a song, Jeev Jago, Jeev Jago. Very wonderful song. Wake up, wake up. You have slept so long on the lap of Maya. The Lord speaks, I have descended to come to you in your life and save you. Other than myself, who else is your true friend? I have brought the medicine for destroying the illusion of Maya. Now beg for this medicine. Beg for this Maha Mantra and take it. He doesn't say just go and chant. He says, first beg for it. And there is a very, very delightful little detail why we should ask for the charity of the Holy Name. Real bhakti is not something that can be accomplished by us. As long as we consider ourselves the doers, we will remain bewildered by our false ego. And false ego means just this one thing. It means to put Krishna out of the center and to put yourself into the center of the life. That is the false doership. That is the activity of the false ego, which is there. So as long as you are in the center, how will love for Krishna be your main concern? You will always have love for yourself as your main concern. So therefore, a devotee who understands, oh my Lord, I'm covered. And I see this very, very, very clearly when I try to chant your name and take shelter of you? Have you known that the best servant of the ego, the mind, will not like this? You chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna. The mind thinks, oh, this I have to do, that I have to do. And there was this one devotee who had this very good app, you know, which tells you immediately what are the best sport shoes. I need that app also. Let me catch up with him very quickly. The mind goes to all types of subjects just to avoid this one subject, Krishna. And you see that because he is the servant of the false ego, of the self-serving mentality that I want to be happy here. No? And therefore, this is a great problem. You sit down and chant, and I've given multiple retreats now. And when I meet privately with the participants, I say, please tell me, what is your greatest difficulty in chanting? And throughout the world, everywhere, India as well as America, the Silicon Valley as well as Florida, you know, it's a cross-globe problem. Even in Iceland, I was once for book distribution, and there were devotees there. All my inquiry has always brought the same obstacle. They say, yes, the mind, you know, the mind is not willing to take shelter at Krishna's lotus feet. It just runs everywhere, and therefore, very often when you see devotees, they chant like this, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Have you seen them? I think if you would make a video of devotees trying to concentrate and trying to control the mind, you, oh Krishna, this would not be a good movie on the Hare Krishna. People would say, no, I don't want to go into this. You know, they're trying to fight with the mind. Because the mind doesn't want. It's the servant of the false ego. Haridas Thakur addresses this, and he therefore says, why you should beg for the holy name? Why you should not think I know to chant? Why you should think, oh Krishna, please help me. I have written this down and I will read it the way it is translated here. The devotee should make it a regular practice to spend a little time alone in a quiet place and concentrate deeply on the holy name. He should utter and hear the name distinctly. This is how it starts. You have to listen further. It's not that in this quote everything is there. No. This quote leads us to something. So, okay, what have we just heard? I should be for myself, and I should make, what was it? I should concentrate deeply on the holy name. What does this mean, please? Ah, here. I should utter and hear the name distinctly. Okay, clear pronunciation, and what was it? Once again, I'm so forgetful about everything. But, oh yeah, here, I should hear it distinctly. All right, I got it. I think I have the method now. I got the trick. Sit alone. What was it? Yes. Utter distinctly. Okay. And then hear distinctly. Good. Hare Krishna, hearing. What is about this new app, really? sorry. Oh, I mean, I'm disturbed with this facial hair in our movement. That's really a disturbance. Oh, sorry. What's about my Facebook? Oh, this one. I want to show you realistically, if you try to concentrate by uttering and hearing the name distinctly, most probably after some time you will slip, you will fall. It's like walking on a side of the road, and you step on a banana peel and whoops! You lie there, not the ground. No? This is what happens. Therefore, we need to listen to the second part of this quotation. It is impossible for the living entity to single-handedly avoid and overcome the illusion of distraction. Impossible. However, now a solution comes. By the mercy of the Lord, this can be accomplished very easily. Therefore, it is essential to prayerfully beg for the Lord's grace with great humility, for this is the only means to salvation from this problem. So this is called namashraya, taking shelter. When someone who takes shelter doesn't walk in pride, he is a needy person in need of some sympathy, some gift of some charity, in fact. And this taking shelter, namashraya, is how you can approach the holy name. You go to him, you go to Chani, and you ask sincerely, my Lord, victory over this wandering function of the mind is not possible for me alone without your help. Why not? Because the mind doesn't follow what I tell him. The mind follows what the ego tells him. Help me to be in the center. Therefore the mind always works as a faithful servant. But if you change that ego, I can do it. It's on my own. It's a matter of applying the right techniques. Then I get it all straight. If you take shelter at the holy name and beg for the single-handed mercy of the holy name, then yes, there is great hope. Especially in kirtan, it is very, very easy. When you sit in the kirtan of the holy name, where many devotees are engaged in chanting, there you all of a sudden can feel some great mercy coming down on you, some mercy, and you are with the holy name, it's smooth sailing, so to say. I remember in many kirtans, you know, the kirtan leader, it's not always a pleasant service. You have to pull your audience into another space. Sometimes they're not willing to come. You feel like a big metal wall between you and the audience. And then you know, and you can't bring them, especially a Hare Krishna audience of devotees. You know, they are doing everything so often, but not so deeply. And therefore have developed bad habits and so on. I'm a little bit too critical. It's not exactly like this. But then you all of a sudden notice, wow, the atmosphere has changed. Wow, everyone is chanting, and even I am chanting properly. Wonderful. What has happened? That's the mercy of Krishna, who has descended and given shelter to the conditioned souls. So, in this last lecture, I wanted to speak about the wonderful privilege of being sheltered at the lotus feet of the Lord, and speak about the main process that is going to the most accessible form of the Lord, that is His holy name, that was in my mind. And then I wanted to say that namashaya, or taking shelter in the holy name, is the way you can get the mercy of the holy name. Yeah, approach him like a beggar and ask him, please give me shelter. This is the main symptom of a Vaishnava in this world. He asks for shelter. He is free from that ignorant notion that he is the doer, the only doer. He understands more, I'm like a pen. Yes, something is done. Yes, some ink is, yes. Pen is also important, no? But I'm moved by the hand of the Lord, and therefore he's there asking for shelter, not thinking I'm doing everything on my own. There's nothing better than being a pen. This is something which should not be quoted in isolation. Nothing better than being an instrument, let us say it like this. Instrument feels happy. Instrument has no worries. Instrument is blissful. I mean, when it's held by the hand of the Lord. You know? So, therefore, Namashaya will make you really happy, my dear devotees. It's so. Taking shelter. Oh, wonderful. Good. I have come to the end of this lecture. Thank you very much for listening to me so often. A little humbled by your attention. Please, this is very good. Krishna consciousness is very good, my dear devotees. In the beginning, when we come to Krishna consciousness, we say, I hope it works. And when we are in the middle, we think, maybe it works. Not sure, but maybe. And later, you know, by our experience, it does work. This is what I so much appreciated in Srila Prabhupada. I had been in the fortunate position to be for a few days not his main servant, but to assist his servant. And I would do simple things like guard his door, and you know, very simple things. One day I was just guarding the door that there would be no noise, and before the storm, he could concentrate on his work. One day, I remember, the door went open. There was no one before the door except for me. I was just sitting there. It opened slowly and carefully. The one who had opened the door must have looked around. Is it free there? And then I saw Prabhupada moving past me. He either didn't look at me or he didn't see me, but he walked. So we lived in a castle at that time, and his rooms were up, and there was before his room, it's called in German eine Balustrade, you know. Try to speak it in English, a balustrade. Is that an English word? Yeah. Who is English speaking? Balustrade, does it say something to you? No, it's like it's before. You can enter this space, it's connecting all the rooms which are there, and you can then look down in the main hall from it.
Balcony,
maybe? Or do you have something in English like empore?
Landing.
Yeah. I think you got the idea. So Prabhupada went there, and he moved very, I've never forgotten it, very slowly. It was like this. He was looking at everything. He was very deep in thought. He moved there, then he came back into his room. I made sure that I was not disturbing, I was also not looking at him. I was giving him the private space, which obviously he wanted to have. And I saw a person who was absolutely absorbed in another reality. It looked really like a being from another planet. And this made me extremely curious. Like, how is Prabhupada now in his private rooms? I mean, I could not look at him now because I didn't want to disturb him, but I'm going to look at him and I'm going to trace him in his private rooms. So the next day, I climbed up the walls of the castle. When I knew it was his resting time, I used the lightning conductor. Very safe. Came over the railing of the balcony, ducked in like a marine soldier. Then I went up to the window of his sleeping room and I wanted to look through the window. It was open because it was summer, and I saw him as I had planned, resting on his bed. He was really in a private space. At that time, I noticed something very amazing. There was a sound in the room, very softly chanting. And when I looked closer, I saw that his lips were moving in the sleep. I heard this. And I thought, oh God, my God, he's not really sleeping. He's chanting also. Ooh, this means he could see me. And I immediately went down and fled the balcony. What if he opens the eye and then I'm in trouble? That I intruded into his private space and his friend just went down. I almost fell. I was so elated and so happy. He chanted in his sleep. Wonderful. So this is someone who has taken shelter at Krishna's lotus feet. His consciousness is so much absorbed in this world, so much absorbed as Krishna, that he was able to deliver Krishna to the Western world. He was able to inspire a movement, an international movement. And he was able to write literature which people nowadays pick up and they feel drawn to Krishna consciousness just by reading this realized world. Taking shelter at Krishna's lotus feet and taking shelter at the holy name is an absolutely wonderful path to take. It is a path which brings you away from illusions, away from fears, away from troubles, and it brings you into your constitutional position of being a servant of Krishna. So, Hare Krishna, I am now reached the end. I will not take questions at this moment. If there are questions, you could ask them at the beginning of our last session. It's the closing session. It's taking the retreat home. Please do come, if possible. It goes from 11 o'clock to 11 o'clock to 1:30. I realize that some of you have to go around 12 o'clock. Can you come? Yes, you can also come and then we will say goodbye to you and you have to go. Good. I wish you a very good prasada with a healthy fire of digestion and see you at 11 o'clock. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
And just one thing, if you forget everything you have heard, Remember one word, Namashraya, taking shelter at the Holy Name.
Well, you know, that was so good. Yeah.
It's for you. Here and here. If you have it here, this is better. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Do you know Lalita already? Lalita is a social worker. Lalita, just wait, because they have to go. Kommt doch kurz. Nee, man, darf ich sitzen bleiben? Ich sitze so lange, wie ich will, noch kommen. Ja, also, nochmals, ich habe wirklich gesehen, wie
Das war jetzt das Spiel, der ich jetzt am Ende.